Good evening, everybody. Welcome to After Hours. I'm Jack Hammer.
And I'm Andre Kane. Joining us tonight is Donna Lewis. She's going to be performing her smash hit, I Love You, Always Forever.
Also on the show tonight, we're talking weapons.
Wah!
Wada!
Ja!
From the TV show Warriors on the History Channel, we have host Terry Schapper joining us right here
on After Hours.
Are you changing jobs? Have you recently been laid off and don't know what your options are? Do you feel like you've hit a brick wall and want better control of your finances? I can help.
Call Carlos Perez at 845-559-4692.
BBE Designs Black Belt Embroidery, your personal embroiderer. With custom embroidery, screen printing, photo transfers, and more, that's BBE Designs in Cornwall.
Right now, we'd like to welcome to the show from the History Channel's new TV show, Warriors.
My name is Terry Schapper. I'm a Green Beret sent on combat and training missions around the world. But I'm part of a long line of elite warriors tested in battle. And the only way to reveal their weapons and tactics is to experience them myself. I'm about to find out what it takes to be a Viking warrior.
Vikings. For centuries, these Norse fighters ravaged Europe. They were the most feared and hated warriors of their time. They've been called pirates, raiders, heathens. But I want to know who these men really were. How and why did they fight?
Terry Schapper.
What's up, man? How you doing?
Nice, guys.
Terry?
Good to see you,
man.
Good to see you guys again.
Good seeing you, man.
Welcome.
Last time I talked to you cats, it was like, a week and a half ago at the radio show.
Yeah.
And
then,
that's amazing, man, that you came here, too.
So. To the abandoned warehouse. This is awesome.
Doesn't this look like the Riddler's lair, actually?
I tell you, when I was following you here, too, I thought something bad's going to happen. It's great, man. You walk inside, you're in a totally different world, so it's really cool.
So you got to tell everybody how you landed Warriors on History Channel.
Well, I actually got that job by a homemade audition tape. My wife and I made this. I was in Special Forces for a long time, got out, went to acting school, was getting that career going, came back in after 9/11. So every time I'd go on a combat deployment, I'd come back, I'd get some acting gigs, and it's kind of like sort of stalling your career. But then through a long series of phone calls and people hooking me up, I got put with this agency. And one time they said, hey, listen, we need you to make a tape if you can for this new show they're doing a pilot for. It's about warrior culture. And they gave me some criteria. And I went out to my town in Beacon and was running around with a sword and just talking. I know. People were actually stopping, like going, the hell's going on here with this guy?
Wow.
And I sent that in. And without meeting a history exec or a production person, I actually got the job. So
that's incredible.
Yeah, I got lucky. I got really lucky. And it's been so much fun.
What was the first thing you shot for Warriors? What was your first?
The first thing we did actually was a pilot back about a year ago now, actually, in Scotland. And so we did a show on the Scottish medieval warrior culture, William Wallace and the Battle of Stirling Bridge.
William Wallace!
Yeah, he's 7 foot tall. He is a pretty big guy, actually, apparently, from all records. But so we were in Scotland, and we filmed the pilot. And, you know, it takes these guys a while to make this stuff. So months went by, and finally, History showed it, and it did very well, and so they green-lighted it to a series. So we started filming in September, and I just kind of got done, you know?
Wow, that's incredible. So during your filming, have you ever gotten, like, hurt doing any of this stuff? Or?
Well, yes. Actually, I get hurt pretty much almost every week because I'm old. I'm not that skilled, and it's just the way it works. And you're using sharp weapons and hammers. So pretty much every week, I call it Terry Schapper gets effed up week, you know. Something happens to me, sometimes bad, sometimes not so bad. The first episode that you saw that aired about a week and a half ago, I actually cut my leg open with this Mayan war club, this pieces of obsidian on it, ripped open my leg, which was, you know,
that was a pretty serious injury.
I knew it was bad. I didn't think it was bad because it's so darn sharp. It's like a scalpel opening up your leg. And I was whipping around, I came back and I thought, oh, I think I just scratched myself. And I kind of tried to blow it off. And then I felt blood running down into my boot. So I was like, I should probably check this out.
Wow.
Yeah, no big deal. So I looked and I was like, yeah, it's pretty deep. It went through the skin, through the fat, into the muscle. But it wasn't bleeding that bad, man. Because it was so sharp.
That's amazing. Right. You could take that edge down to how thick?
A molecule.
What?
If you fracture that stuff right, man, you can. It's as sharp as any scalpel you can produce commercially today.
Wow.
Yeah, man. These guys are using
incredible.
This stuff back then. Yeah. It was pretty. It's pretty good demonstration of like, you know, you don't need high tech to kill somebody, you know.
Wow.
And you can check it out on history.com. You can go and see past episodes of Warriors up there. And what was your favorite?
Lacerating
your leg open with
that was a good one. That was a good one because there were howler monkeys involved. It's a long story. So that was a don't judge. We got along well. I think you know all of them are really. It's the furniture, dude.
You can actually throw this back.
You've got
you
to go. Be.
How tell my, me Davis how Furniture my, didn't hook us up.
How am I supposed to talk now?
I'm so how close. Great is this?
This is actually cooler than the stuff I got in my house. This is. I want to take this with me when I go.
Well, just bring the family by.
I'm going to bring the family by and just set up the TV and just go, look, that's Terry on Warriors right there. They were all really, actually, all the episodes were cool. Not to be politician about it because they were all great, but the most exotic probably would have been South Africa with the Zulus because, you know, as soon as I show up, I get off this truck, you know, this Land Rover, and all these the Zulu people come out. They're in full Zulu regalia. All these little kids, a group of orphans that was being taken care of there. They're singing my name. And it was just really...
Singing your name?
Oh, yeah. They did a song for me. And so they're welcoming me into their community.
Wow, that's incredible.
For that week that I was there with them. And it was really cool. And they were very nice. And they're pretty tough. They're very tough guys, actually. But
do they speak English?
They speak English. Most of them speak English. Of course, they speak Zulu dialect as well. And some of them speak Afrikaans.
You know, did you learn anything?
They have a lot of Zulu words. In that language, a lot of the words are based on the sounds that things make.
Oh, okay.
So this one spear that I was using was called an ikwa, which is the sound it makes when you stick it in somebody's gut, and when you pull it out,
oh,
the guts come
kidding.
Out. Yeah, it's the name of the spear.
Wow.
And their word for a tractor is gunda gunda, because it makes that noise. So, yeah, that's their language. They do a lot of African languages are like that. And they were just really nice guys, and we did a bunch of crazy stick fighting, and there's one scene, too, where there's like 120 of these cats coming over the hill at me. And I was like, oh boy, this would have been scary.
That is
back
insane.
Then.
You
that
know what the sound for us scary. Asking a raise is?
Yeah. <right. laughs> That's you look at the camera go, I need to change my clothes.
So I was watching some of the episodes, and it looks like, and we actually talked about this a little bit backstage. It looks like when you guys are like doing some of these moves that you're actually like really hitting each other pretty hard.
Yeah, you got it. Some of it is. I mean, we talked. I mean, you can't just go, all right, you, me, swords, let's go.
Right.
Because someone's going to lose a limb. You know, right. It's only TV, man. So let's not do that. So right. We work it out a little bit between each other. Okay, you know, and we'll talk about that kind of stuff. And, you know, every time I met with one of those guys, whatever culture it was, I'd have some time with them, kind of get to know them, so you could sort of tell if they were cool, and everybody was. And we kind of work it out, but you got to go for it, too.
Right, of course.
If it's fake looking, it's just not going to work.
Real,
yeah,
right.
People are going to go, that's BS. So it's got to be real, but you can't get hurt, you know?
Right.
So, yeah, it's kind of, you got to walk that line a little bit.
Very cool, man.
Yeah, it was, hey, man, I'm living a boy's dream. I mean, I'm still in the military, I'm still a Green Beret, and now I get to be in front of the camera and tell stories, talk about warrior cultures that I, as a soldier, have studied my whole life. And I'm actually walking on the battlefields, meeting experts, fighting with their weapons.
So
if I complained about that, you guys would deserve to beat the hell out of me.
You're still in the military.
I sure am.
You're still active?
Well, I mean, I'm in the National Guard Special Forces. I was active duty for 9 years.
Okay.
When I came back in after 9/11, I joined the National Guard.
Now, how were they with the show? Were they okay?
They were very cool. They were very supportive. Yeah, because, you know, I've given up a lot of... on the three deployments since 9/11, I've given up a lot of acting gigs, a lot of performing stuff.
Right.
I don't regret it at all, man.
Right.
It was the right thing to do. But when I got this job, my commander said, if you get this job, go crush it and represent
really
us well.
Cool. Really
so,
cool.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah, I got really lucky. I mean, things have really lined up really well for me.
Excellent.
Yeah.
You brought some weapons and stuff with you?
I brought show and tell stuff.
I'm a little scared.
Don't be scared, Andre. Don't be scared. Don't be scared.
You know what? Let's take a break.
Let's take a break
because I want to do some showing before
we're going to actually do some real. We're going to do some real warrior stuff in this place. They don't even know what they're in for yet.
Oh,
all man. Right, we're going to be back more with After Hours right here. Stay with us.
For disc duplication, film, tape, and audio transfers and printing services, visit www.multimediaservicecenter.com.
Honey, the insurance man is here.
Okay, honey, send him out. And bring out the mustard.
Hi, Luke. Just stopped by to review your insurance.
Yeah, I appreciate you coming by. I know you guys don't do many house calls these days.
Well, it's my pleasure.
But you know what? I don't think I need insurance. This house is solid as a rock. What's the worst thing that could happen?
But what if something does happen?
Where do I sign?
Hunter Insurance Services. Real insurance for the real world. Call us at 778-1000.
I'm Andre Kane.
We're back with more with Terry Shepard from the History Channel's new TV show, Warriors. And the hell do you got?
Imagine the looks of people in the airport in Germany walking through this. So one of the benefits of the show so far, too, is that, you know, I've gotten to come home with all sorts of weapons and shields and scary things. So I am going to build the Terry Shepard Museum. No one's going to come.
but
damn it, I know there is one. I'm an old guy going, I remember when I fought with that. Yeah, that's great, Grandpa, great. But I have all this crazy stuff. A lot of the stuff is not here because the production company still was using it for green screen and for the show.
Okay.
And some stuff I actually got to get home. This is one of the first things I brought home. This is actually from Germany, and it was made by a German guy who's into all this primitive culture, and he's remade a lot of things. And this is a shield at the Barbarians, which you're going to see in a week. And if you watch the show, that's going to premiere on the Barbarians versus the Romans. This is the kind of shield they had. And it's great because
it's heavy?
Pick it up. And the way it's constructed, too, it's made with wood that's kind of like bonded together. Mm-hmm. And then this is stretched. This is animal hide that's wet and stretched across. And then it's sewn with linen thread. The paint is actually made of different kind of vegetable dyes. And it's also got a layer of beeswax
That's
on top
incredible.
To prevent really? It from getting soaked. And this is the kind of shield those cats would fight with because it's really light.
Wait a minute. This says made in Taiwan.
Well, I had to say that to get it through customs.
Wow, that's incredibly balanced.
It really is.
Because you can hold it.
Right, and you can twist it. Yep.
And like if you had your arm in there, you could really just use this as almost like a buckler almost.
You're exactly right. It is bucklerish, and you can. These guys, the way they would fight too, they would twist it a lot, and then it would come at you like this.
Wow!
And a lot of times, this little hand protector, the boss.
What do we call that? The knob? The what?
The boss.
The boss.
The hand protector. Boss. Yeah, the boss. And a lot of times, these were spiked, so you could actually, you know, if the guy got too close, you could smack it. So, big thing with shields. A lot of people think of them as only defensive. This is actually a weapon. This is a weapon.
Wow.
You got something here, and you've got a shield. This is a weapon. You'll kill a dude with this. And especially some of these were like had metal, and they were like really sharpened, so it was like scary.
Wow.
So that's the shield. Now this is something I brought. This just to the uninitiated eye, this would look like a big piece of wood.
It looks like a piece of wood.
And it is a big piece of wood. But what this is a replica of the boat oar that Miyamoto Musashi, one of the world's most famous swordsmen of Japan.
Okay.
He had this big duel on this little island. One of those things like you be there at 10 o'clock, I'll be there at 10 o'clock.
Okay.
He shows up late to mess with the guy's head. And so as he's showing up, he's taking a boat oar and he's carving this piece of wood. You know, this is the greatest swordsman in Japan, and he's carving a piece of wood. So he just steps off the boat, and his opponent, who was another top samurai, almost as good as him, really, in a way, is enraged. He goes, "What the? You're bringing a piece of wood to fight me?"
Right.
So he used this. He carved it. It was just longer than his opponent's Kojiro, his sword. So it was just a little bit longer, and he also had this big knot on his head. Musashi did, this big rag. So Kojiro comes at him with his sword, goes right over, cuts the knot because he underestimates the distance. And as soon as he does that, Musashi comes over the top, bangs him right over the head. Kojiro tries to move again. He bangs him, breaks his chest, kills the guy, like basically two blows with a piece of wood.
And it's not.
Gets back in the boat and sails away.
So. It's not sharp or anything.
No, nothing's sharp about it all. There's angles on it, though, which will really kind of give you little bit of whoop ass there.
So you would really have to put a lot of power behind.
Yeah, and I actually got to use this in the samurai show, and it's actually pretty well balanced. And it just Musashi was one of my he's always been a hero of mine.
Wow.
And it's kind of cool that I got to fight with something that he made, you know what I mean?
Wow.
So that's that. And it just goes to show you again, you don't really need high tech as a weapon.
Right.
You know, that's another
right.
theme in the show Warriors too. a lot of people ask me, oh, you know, because we use in our modern day, we use all sorts of guns, optics, and all that kind of stuff. And it's pretty badass. But it's really about the guy.
Now, this thing scares me.
Well, it should.
I saw this outside.
It ought to, because, you guys are like, what the hell am I looking at? Well, what this is called the Leomano, which is a Hawaiian word. And it's, again, about as simple as that. It's a piece of wood. There's a lot of good hardwood in Hawaii. And these are tiger shark teeth that have been holes drilled in. And then they route cord through, and it's this intricate groove lace system. And this is ingenious to me because the tiger shark, the reason the tiger sharks were so prized is because the way their teeth were structured, they curve this way. A lot of shark teeth come straight out, which are also good, but this is even better because it curves, so it's got this surface this way. So as you would, these guys that fight like this, they'll hit you, they'll wrap around you, and then they get you on the way back too, like this.
Oh,
and this thing just...
So you're just...
You just basically eviscerate a guy, and if that's not good enough, you could come around with a spike and just eye him in the face. And so you should see these cats fighting Hawaii with this.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, this is about as simple, and this is a small one. Some of them got really big.
Looks like a Hawaiian hairbrush.
Yeah, this is sort of like similar to the thing in Guatemala that cut my leg open.
This weapon is awesome. I mean, it's just a simple idea, a piece of wood, you know, with some glass in the end of it, but it's brutal. Wait. Look at this. As I was swinging it and I came back around, I felt it nick my leg. That's a pretty serious gash right there, and I barely nicked it. Get the, I think there's steri strips in there. I'm gonna have to seal it. That might actually need sutures. It's deep.
That one was made of a volcanic glass. This is shark's teeth. Again, the Hawaiians during this time had no metal. No metal at all in their culture. So this is what they made stuff with. So it was kind of really neat. This is actually presented to me at the end of the filming. All of these were given to me kind of as gifts. And,
wow.
That is really
cool.
Yeah,
but it's fun, you know. And these guys actually gave this to me in a little ceremony and said, hey, you know, we really appreciated working with you. And I actually made one on the show. You'll see me working on one. But this is the finished one that they gave me.
That's really cool.
It's going to be in the Terry Shepard Museum if you guys want to come someday.
Oh, I could do that, man.
I'll give you guys tickets and, you know.
Sounds great.
Now, my wife is like, of course, she's really jazzed because I'm... She's like, where are we going to put all this crap? I go, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's my house. We'll figure out a way. If I have to build my own wing, I'm going to do it.
Wow, man.
Call it the Shap Wing.
It's the Shepard Wing. And I'll have my pipe smoking stuff there. I'll have my pictures, my weapons.
Yeah, and this couch.
So P.S., don't mess with Terry Shepard.
Hey, you laugh, bro. This is coming with me. Might not come today. You're going to come in here one day and go, where the f*** is this
what?
And guess what?
We'll just come to your house.
And you're going to guess what? And that means you're going to have to come to the Terry Shepard Museum. Gotcha.
You know what's going to be funny? Is Terry's going to take the couch. You're still going to be tethered to it.
I'm not moving. Wherever this couch goes, I'm going.
So basically, you'll be part of the museum. I'll have people feed him.
Sounds good.
That's Andre. Don't make eye contact with him.
As soon as he dies, I make weapons from his teeth.
And I use his skin to make a lampshade. No, I'm just kidding. You're safe. You're safe
good.
At the Terry Shepard
good,
Museum.
Good.
So yeah, man, that was it.
Because your toys do scare me.
You know,
I wouldn't want to mess with you.
It's funny, because this one, I had a Norwegian shield, a Viking shield, that I carried through all these airports, and there was no problem. For some reason, the Germans were not so happy with this. And so they're like, that is a weapon. I go, yeah, you must check that. You can't bring that on the
really?
Plane. I was trying to get it on the plane.
You're crazy.
I thought it was festive. I mean, it's loose.
Man, you didn't bring it on going,
yeah. I didn't have, like, you know, the Braveheart paint. Those guys. That's been one of the best parts of the show, though, is like the end of it. I have more stuff for the museum. And it's cool because most of them have all been given as gifts.
That's cool.
For appreciation.
So
yeah,
awesome.
You know what
that's
I mean? And
awesome.
That's kind of actually a warrior tradition. It really is. Even in special forces, when we go and train with other dudes, mm-hmm. whether it's in the Middle East or in my case, when I lived in Europe with special forces, worked all over Europe. Anytime we go there, like, we present each other with stuff, plaques, gifts. It's kind of like that's sort of a common thing where, you know,
really,
what you
really
give
cool.
them something and they give you something back, and it's kind of maintains that tradition. So yeah, it's really great.
It's totally awesome.
Awesome.
You got
Very
a chance
cool.
you gonna stick around with us for a little while?
Yeah, man. I got nothing to do, man. It's Sunday.
Awesome. Terry Shepard's gonna hang out with us more on After Hours.
We'll be
Stay
right
with
back.
Us.
I'm Jack Hammer. It's time for the Insurance Moment, brought to you by Hunter Insurance, and I'm joined by Keith Hunter. Keith, welcome to After Hours, buddy.
Thank you, Jack.
Let's talk about motorcycle insurance. Everybody's itching to get out and ride. What's the difference in the rates?
Okay, sure. You know, if you're a middle-aged guy riding a cruiser like you and I, the rates are really reasonable. If you're a young guy riding a sport bike, it gets kind of pricey. Mm-hmm. And if you're lucky enough to have a handmade custom chopper, there's actually very few carriers that will even entertain insuring those, and it does get kind of expensive.
Wow. Now, what's the deal with no-fault insurance motorcycles in New York? What's that about?
In New York State, there is no no-fault coverage for the driver of a motorcycle. And the no-fault covers people when they're in a car accident, pays for their medical bills, and pays their lost wages. I guess the industry figures if you're psychotic enough to drive a motorcycle on these streets, you're on your own.
So what does a rider do to protect himself against that?
You can buy a personal disability policy that'll replace your lost wages, and you can also look to your medical insurance to pay the medical bills.
That's one way of doing it. Thank you, Keith. Okay. Thanks for hanging out with us on After Hours. That's the Insurance Moment, brought to you by Hunter Insurance.
Honey, the insurance man is here.
Okay, honey, send him out and bring out the mustard.
Hi, Luke. Just stop by to review your insurance.
Yeah, I appreciate you coming by. I know you guys don't do many house calls these days.
Well, it's my pleasure.
But you know what? I don't think I need insurance. This house is solid as a rock. What's the worst thing that could happen?
But what if something does happen?
Where do I sign?
Hunter Insurance Services. Real insurance for the real world. Call us at 778-1000.
Welcome back to After Hours. Please welcome Donna Lewis.
Yeah. This resign is so who you to me. You're one of a kind, forever leaving behind a little bit of your love, a little piece of your clear sky, turning on the lights in my heart. And I wasn't aware you came in the wind, the way a beautiful dream comes back to you. I'm sure I've never felt this sweet before. You and me are all, you're everything but tragic, everything that's good inside me. You're everything I need to solve and let the dream. Do you see what I
Chopin, your local Caterpillar dealer, is your number one source for sales, rentals, parts, and service of construction and landscaping equipment. Skid steel loaders, mini excavators, backhoe loaders, and more. Call your local Chopin branch for details on excellent finance packages currently available.
Are you changing jobs? Have you recently been laid off and don't know what your options are? Do you feel like you've hit a brick wall and want better control of your finances? I can help.
Call Carlos Perez at 845-559-4692.
BBE Designs, Black Belt Embroidery, your personal embroiderer. With custom embroidery, screen printing, photo transfers, and more, that's BBE Designs in Cornwall.
Stage right now, a woman with an angelic singing voice. Ladies and gentlemen, Donna Lewis.
Donna, thank you so much for being here on After Hours.
It's lovely to be here. Thank you.
No problem.
And that was so sweet, an angelic voice. Isn't that lovely?
It really is. There's not a lot of musicians and vocalists that when you're singing or performing that you can take somebody to a different place. It's a sound that's so unique. And when you can sit there and close your eyes and you're no longer here, but you're completely somewhere else.
Especially the song Ireland on your new album.
A lot of people mentioned that.
I love that song.
I know, thank you. Well, I think, you know, the inspiration for that was when I was living in Ireland, actually. We rented a house after the first record to do the second one. And I had such an amazing view of Dublin Bay. I used to take a photograph of it every morning because it would change. And that really, I wanted to write a song about that. And Ireland is the one.
Wow.
Off my new record, actually.
Yeah, actually, we got to talk about that. Let's go back to I Love You Always Forever. I remember playing that as a brand new hit. And now we talked backstage. Now, you said there was no real major push for this.
Not really.
Was it just radio that did it?
It really was. I mean, I think, you know, at the time, I mean, people were very into that song at the label, but it was just put to radio. And I think they were just going to see how it went. And radio picked up on it, thank goodness. And you know, we were talking backstage, as you say, that it was number 31 in the Billboard charts before we had even made the video. I mean,
wow.
It was like, oh, we better do a video, we better do this. And so it was just a fantastic surprise, you know, for it to do so well.
Now, what was the inspiration behind that song? Why did you write that song?
Why did I write it? Probably I was so depressed in my house in Birmingham. No. You know, I was reading a book, For the Love of Lydia, which is a very romantic English novel about love. And basically, I had the music all written first. It was on my little Korg M1, and I was telling somebody else backstage earlier that song was all the sounds on my Korg M1. I just conjured up this little beat. And the brass, I mean, it was all sort of corny brass and organ, but it really worked. And then I wrote the lyrics for it afterwards. And it was just one of those songs, you know, in the studio when we recorded it, we wanted to make it more interesting. We brought in a real Hammond organ sound. I think I had a brass section. We did this, we did that. And when we heard it at the end of the day, it just lost all the magic the original demo had. So we went back.
Wow.
To get all those original sounds back, and I redid the vocals, and that was it.
Now, we usually ask this about every musician and vocalist that comes here. Who were your influences growing up?
Growing up, I listened to everything from Stevie Wonder to David Bowie. T-Rex was my big thing at that time.
Wow.
But I think as a writer, Ricky Lee Jones, I'm a big fan of hers. The Blue Nile, who are a Scottish band, mm-hmm. who I love. Peter Gabriel, all sorts of different artists.
Your music, to me, paints a picture. And I love that artistic quality. I mean, any song
Absolutely.
That really paints a picture and you can, you know, think about it in your mind, and your music does that, and
I love it.
Thank
you. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah.
So what was between I Love You Always Forever and your new CD? What happened in there?
In that 12-year gap. Oh, my gosh. well, I did the second record, which, you know, did okay, but Atlantic, you know, people had changed at Atlantic. It didn't mm-hmm. have enough support. So I left. And then I did an acoustic record, Be Still, which was great. You know, I really wanted to get back to doing an acoustic performance type of record. And then I did a lot of collaborative work. I worked with a bunch of Italian remixers in Naples, which was really interesting. We did a bunch of dance stuff together.
And you had a couple hits, right?
We did. Like one was a big hit in Ibiza, yes. Mm-hmm. But that was a lot of fun. And then I worked with a bunch of different people, David Torn, who's a film composer. And it was really refreshing for me just to get away from the whole Atlantic thing and, you know, just a breath of fresh air doing
right.
something different. And then I had a baby. And I think I thought, it was so funny, you know, I had all these songs written. I thought, oh, yeah, while he's sleeping, 6 months old, I can do a bit in the studio and I can do this and that. And You know, what was I thinking? There was just no time. Right. And also, I think, you know, being I just wanted to be a full-on mum. Mm-hmm. And so that's why this record took a few years to actually finish, all in all, because I just love being a mum and I just, you know, that was my life for a while. So basically, that's what happened in 12
years.
Well,
that's great.
Wow, that's great. Now, Donna, your new CD is In the Pink.
In the Pink.
Now, how did that title come about?
Well, the first record was Now in a Minute, which is a very Welsh expression we use, which makes no sense whatsoever. But I just thought, I don't know. This record, you know, it was a feel-good record. It'd been a while since I had a record out. And In the Pink in Britain is, you know, feeling great, feeling good. I'm in the pink, so...
Very good.
That's how
excellent.
It came about.
What about your band? Let's talk about your band is awesome.
Yeah.
Really,
yeah,
really great.
Very guys.
Cool.
Well, those guys recorded the record with me.
Okay.
And I've known Jerry, the guitarist, for, oh my gosh, 12 years, because he did my first record with me. And he introduced me to Jeff and Doug. And we did the record with those guys, and they were awesome. And, I really feel lucky that I have them here when I can play, because they're just a bunch of great musicians. And I think we just create a really amazing atmosphere when we play.
And it's always great to have a history with the band, you know?
Yeah.
Like a good chemistry together.
You know, an Irishman, a Welsh lady. You know,
it all works out, right?
Yes, exactly.
Now, Jerry played with David Bowie?
He did.
What?
And he was his MD for a while too. Yes.
Wow.
He's been around that Jerry.
Now, how long was Jerry together with David Bowie, and how did you score?
You mean how did I score with David?
Yeah, well, no. How did you? Well, that's a Brooklyn term for it. Hey, look, lady. Basically, you know, here's Jerry playing with David Bowie. Now, how did you two guys hook up to, first off, do your first record and continue on that relationship?
Yeah, well, the first record, after going through an interesting first record in Canada with a producer, which, let's just say, was an interesting experience. We did it again in New York with Kevin Killen, who's Irish. Great guy, and he said, we'll get this guitarist friend of mine, Jerry Leonard. He's Irish, you'll love him. And of course, that's how we first met. And of course, he brought his teapot and his tea, and we drank a lot of Irish tea. And, it was great. And we always kept in touch. And then on this record, it just so happened, I don't know whether he'd finished the Bowie tour, and he had like a 3-month break. And, I'm just trying to remember. Yeah, so I had all these songs finished, and out of the blue, I just rang Jerry and I said, look, I really need like somebody to get this record finished. And it just so happened he had like a window of 3 months. And I don't know whether he was going back out with Bowie after that, I can't remember. But he said, okay, and if we do this, we've got to get it done in 3 months. Because I think having a child, I would do a little bit and then I would have a few days here and, you know, change nappies.
That must have been really tough.
Yeah, and sorry, I said nappies, but diapers.
Nappies.
But, you know, and then, so it was a good kick up the bottom to get me going on that record. So we had like a window of 3 months and we just completed it and blah, blah, blah.
That's really, truly incredible.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. So now,
and he lives near me, so I could do vocals at my house. Then he would do a bunch of stuff at his house. He'd pop over. We would work like that. So it was really easy. He has a little girl too, so you know it was easy all round.
On your new CD, what's your favorite song?
Well, Island is one of my all-time favorites.
That's an incredible song.
It's just so atmospheric, and then. You to me because it's Kick Inside, because that's about my son Archie. let me think. They're all so different, but Shout and Sandcastles always is a favorite of mine because it's very dark. It's the dark side of me.
Do you like doing dark music, or is it just a good change for you?
No, I do like depressing music. I have to.
You know
say.
What? I do too.
Yeah, something you can.
I don't know. You guys are just depressing me talking about.
No, something, you know, you can just put on and it's really dark and interesting and you can just lose yourself.
I like
you know?
That too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I like, you know, people don't see that side of me. I think people just see I Love You Always Forever and I'm you know, right. And I really love the kind of dark elements of some music, yeah.
See, we're Big Doors fans. We both like the Doors a lot.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it wasn't always dark. They had a lot of fun music, too. Yeah. But, I mean, it does.
But there were dark overtones.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's really, really cool. And it's just, you know, I just think it's
to me, it's very artistic.
Yes.
And I love that aspect of it.
And it's not a bad thing to go to that place every now and then.
No.
No, it's good. In fact, I think as a writer, you write your best stuff when you're in a very dark place. Very depressed. I'm not depressed. But I'm just saying, you do. I mean, some of my like really slow songs that I've written, Unforgiven on Blue Planet and Silent World, you know, those songs have come from a place I was in, and I think they're one of my best songs, you know, some of my best songs.
Right. People at home right now are going, oh my God, she's depressed.
Yeah. I'm not, really.
Oh, thank goodness for the medication.
No,
that's terrific.
Yes.
And like I said, I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing to go to that place.
No,
we
not
all
at
need
all.
To visit there.
Yeah, I mean, no, to be honest, when I did I Love Yours Forever, I was in. We were living in a house in Birmingham, and it was a great old Victorian house, but it was in kind of a depressing area. And I remember feeling, you know, I was doing piano bars, thinking, okay, this is what I'm going to be doing. You know, my dream was to have a record deal and do my own songs. And, you know, I remember feeling, you know, down in the dumps, because you just think, I just want something to happen.
Right.
So I get a little bit of a break, you know. But I think, you know, so you write great music from that kind of place you were in, you know? And I was extremely prolific at that time. I got that word out, prolific. You know, it's all good. As you say, it's all good to go down there.
Definitely.
You want to talk about dark and depressing? Should we introduce her to Hip?
Oh, wow.
You meet our bartender, Hip.
Really?
Talk about the ultimate in dark and depressing.
Okay.
We'll introduce you to
him.
Okay. More with Donna Lewis on After Hours. Hopefully she'll stick around right after this.
Stay with us.
For disc duplication, film, tape, and audio transfers and printing services, visit www.multimediaservicecenter.com. H.O. Penn, your local Caterpillar dealer, is your number one source for sales, rentals, parts, and service of construction and landscaping equipment. Skid steel loaders, mini excavators, backhoe loaders, and more. Call your local H.O. Penn branch for details on excellent finance packages currently available. Computer problems? Who doesn't have them? Call Intrepid Computing, two locations, Main Street in Cornwall and West Main Street in Goshen. Call today for reasonable rates and fast turnaround. 845-784-7118. 845-784-7118. Computer not rebooting? Time to call Intrepid Computing.
Welcome back to After Hours. Once again, please welcome Donna Lewis.
Feels like I'm standing on a timeless dream. Of discovering you. Those that
my friends. We're bringing you this cheer Mexican style. I'm Andre Kane, and we're hanging out at a place called Rosita's. Now, Rosita's is in Kingston, New York, located right on the Hudson River. It's definitely the hot spot here in town. They have award-winning food, award-winning drinks. You can't get any closer to the Hudson River unless you drink it or swim in it, and you don't want to do either. Believe me when I tell you. This is the first cheer of the night. It's going out to Rosita's in Kingston, New York. You definitely want to check it out. Jack, mi amigo, where are you?
What's up, everybody? It's the Hammer. Andre, what's going on, man? I'm at Sweeney's Pub in Walden, New York on Route 208. Come on by after hours. I'll tell you what, you can get a great meal here, and there's a lot of great cold beer on tap or in bottles. Look at this place. It's gorgeous. You get great food. You get great people to hang around with, and I even heard the mayor hangs out here as well. Got to know it's a great place if the mayor's coming here. It's either this or City Hall, and I choose this. It's Sweeney's Pub, Route 208 in Walden, New York. We'll meet you back at our bar on After Hours for our third cheer. Cheers, everybody.
Welcome back to After Hours. I'm Jack Hammer.
And I'm Andre Kane.
We're joined at the bar with Terry Shepard from Warriors. And now you showed us the sawed-off Bodor.
Awesome, man. That thing was awesome.
And
that's a good way to describe it.
Did you get your beers? Did they work? I mean, they're right here.
Can you use one of those weapons on this thing?
Hey, Terry!
Nice to see you, my friend.
My old buddy. How are you?
Give him the hand. No, Terry went to shake your hand, Hip. What's the matter with you? Be
that's
a gentleman.
Right. That's rude.
I was being a gentleman.
Oh.
What's it to you?
He was just trying to grab some
Look, I don't want to talk to you. I want to talk to Terry.
Okay, talk to Terry.
Hey, Terry, how'd they get you on this show?
I got suckered into it.
Well, I do have to say, Terry,
I was like, they said there was going to be...
Chicks.
and some kind of cartoons.
No, we told you latex, but we had foam rubber.
No, I swear to God, that dude's
sorry.
No, he doesn't mean it.
No.
You know what? There's one too many people in this bar, and I think it's you. Well, hey, look, you're quite the warrior, especially if you're coming on this show.
I had to get prepped.
They didn't send you someplace else, like Discovery would send you out here, where they sent you here.
History doesn't have the kind of budget, apparently, that Discovery does.
They don't have the budget. I'm here. Jeez, you know what? I'll tell you, it's quite a discovery just being with these guys. They went back in time.
What? We did?
No, but being here, I wish I was. Jeez, I'll tell you. Did you bring any good weapons
that
I could, like, chop off his head?
I did. I brought some good weapons, but is he staring at us?
You know what? He doesn't have eyes.
I have eyes. I can see Andre for a mile. And when he comes around that mile, I move the other way. want to meet him.
You know, Terry actually got hurt filming an episode of Warriors on History Channel with a piece of volcanic stone.
Wow. Hey, you know what? You have battle scars like I do. There are two of them out here that I have to deal with.
Has he ever nice to you guys?
Do you see what we got to deal with?
I mean, come on. This is going to cause psychological problems for you, dude.
No, I know.
Being insulted by a fabricated American like
that. He knows your name!
Well, we had a little discussion earlier.
Yes,
didn't
we did. And I've known Terry for a long time. That's the only reason you got him on this show was I promised him some Heineken.
He did. He really did.
It wasn't you.
Is that all I know?
Here we are thinking it was us.
No, it's not you. No, we've gone into battle with you guys before.
I see. Yes. Yes, we have.
So you've been on an adventure outside of this show. What have you been up to, Ter?
For the show, you mean? What, adventure for the show? I've been all over the world, man. All over the world doing swinging weapons, talking strategy, and relaying it to being a warrior today.
And they got you here.
Yeah, they did.
Have a drink.
What have you done?
What have I done?
Yeah.
Well, I did a whole bunch of things before I came here.
Yeah, let's talk about you. I mean, you know, where are those foam hands been?
Nowhere near you.
It'd be kind of hard to shoot a gun with that. Right
yeah.
There.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, I can do really
can you do
well.
It?
Yeah, they're not foamy at all. No.
What was that weapon that you used in the Mayan thing where you actually threw the spear? And it was with...
Yeah. That was an atlatl. So it was what it is like a long javelin, very flexible.
It was what?
Atlatl. Not aflac. not atlatl.
It was atlatl with them being
And he didn't throw it at your latl there.
It's called...
That's the first smart thing you've said.
He just gave you a compliment.
I know he did.
And that's not going to happen.
It's a piece of wood.
It's a.
No, I'm just kidding. Hey, man. We're friends. We're cool. We're cool.
Yeah, we're cool.
Yeah.
So you throw me around the room, I bounce.
He's really freaking me out.
He does. It's like a bad acid trip.
So the atlatl's a piece of wood.
Now you know how I feel, Andre.
You know. Hey,
yeah.
Can you go and check and see if there's more Heineken in the basement?
Sure, I'll be right.
Thanks a lot.
There he goes.
There he goes.
On cue, like that.
That's because I want to get all this control.
All right, so this damn atlatl. So it's a.
He's just waiting for him to come back.
It's really got good for me.
Well, it hasn't got good for me, so there.
So it's a piece of wood, basically. It has different kinds of grips. You can use your fingers or your thumb. And it's just got a little hook at the end.
Okay.
And you attach, basically, you stick a javelin on and just kind of hold it with your finger. And then when you aim it, you flick. And it's basically just using a momentum. I have the physics involved. I couldn't tell you everything.
Okay.
But it's multiplying a lot of the force. And you flick it forward. And actually, the javelin, if you see it like in slow motion, the javelin bends. And then it writes itself, and it has to be a very bendable thing. If it was straight, like a very rigid thing, right. It would just twist around. And this dude was so good. I mean, this cat was killing. I mean, there's people I know.
How good was he?
He was so good that he was calling shots with this damn thing like 50 yards away and making it like over. He even said to me off camera, he goes, man, I'm usually not this good.
Wow.
He was
wow.
just killing it. And most people couldn't hit the damn thing with a gun. He was hitting it with a spear.
Would the spear go through a fabricated American?
Not that one. I don't know. We could probably test it. I have an atlatl at home if we really want.
I think we should.
How far do you want to put? How far do
there
you
are two
it?
More Heinekens left. Not one for you.
Keep them. So, listen, Terry. I want to.
Yeah. Thanks, boys.
Thank you so much for coming.
By the way, you guys noticed too. I've been using the coaster too.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
That's what I'm trying. Out of respect.
Yeah. After we get done, we just rub the bar down with the carpet.
Did you say the B word?
No.
Fabricated American.
So
no, thanks, boys.
So we can catch Warriors on History Channel?
It's every Thursday at 10 is a new episode. Every week's a different warrior culture. Watch me get my butt kicked. But talk about strategy and just relate it to being a modern-day fighter.
You know? Well, I'll tell you, it's like being on this show, watching my butt get kicked every time I go to work with them.
Well, that's so now you understand.
Oh, I totally do.
You'll really relate.
Do you even have a butt?
We'll be watching you on the Discovery Channel.
And if, even
hey,
have
hey,
a
I'll
butt?
Tell you what.
We
if you
can't
ever...
kick your butt. What do we do? Kick your rag? What is that we do to you?
I'm not talking to you anymore.
I'll tell you what.
Anytime you got an opening and you need some target practice, use him.
Okay.
I will. Terry Shepard from the History Channel.
It was a pleasure, guys.
We want to thank Terry so Shepard, and we also want to thank Donna Lewis for coming out tonight. We'll see you next time on After Hours.
Take care.
See you
Have
later.
A good night.